coming up on today's session with the Health Ranger.
Every disease starts from your stomach, basically. Yeah? Yes. So when you eat foods, you go to your stomach. Disease starts from there, okay, yeah? So we need to make sure that what we're eating and putting into our bodies is either two things. It's one thing, basically. Whatever we're eating should be fighting against disease, not making sure we get disease, okay, yeah? So there's a saying, isn't there? You know, you might have heard it. It says, every bite you take, you either feeding disease or you are fighting or healing disease. Before I start, today has just been so far it's been awesome. The thing, the topics we've been talking about, and what's touched my heart about today, because I've done my degree on it, is about a generation, because I work with families and children, is about a fatherless generation. And we just prayed, like me, Alex and Ishmael, about a fatherless generation. And when Gary talked earlier on about in Malachi, one of the scriptures in Malachi 4:6, when it says, you know, I will bring the heart back to the children back to the father, and the heart of the father back to the children. Mm-hmm. I know it's spiritually about us, but I also relate that to the generation now, and that's one of my very much passions about advocating for fathers where, you know, they've lost their place in terms of the family role. Yeah. And I think that, you know, not just myself, we can try and bring that back. No, we need to bring it back. Obviously, we can't bring it back. It's through the Ruach HaKodesh. So I'm just saying, it's something that's really on my heart, and I believe that, you know, we need to break that generational curse, because it's a curse that it causes destruction. Absolutely. And, you know, and how we need to restore and claim that back. And then, so, and I've, as we can see, you know, Brother Dwayne mentioned earlier about life and society and what's going on. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean? You know, the younger generations growing up. You know, if we're not doing Ephesians 6:4, we're nurturing our children and nurturing them and bringing them up in the right way. And it says in Proverbs 22:6, to train up a child. If we're not doing that, then the example is what we're seeing out there. Anyway, back to health. Then again, it is health anyway, but, you know, back to health, okay? It was 2 weeks ago. See, getting ahead of myself here. I mentioned, well, there's 10 kind of areas. The main focus was detoxification. So basically, not about, we always look about what we need to put, not what we're putting in first, but we've got to look at what we need to take out first, or take out of our bodies first, before we put things in, okay? So last week we mentioned, two weeks ago, I do tend to go ahead of myself and get excited. So I will slow down my voice and try and project it so you can hear what I'm saying clearly. Is that okay?
Yes.
Okay. So we talked about fasting, and we talked about also about water, how it purifies us. So if you've missed that, I apologize.
Boy, water machine.
Hallelujah.
Yes. Got one. Yay. Great job. Awesome.
I'm fasting.
Okay, good question. Are you using water supplements, to bring it with the water, because it strips everything out? Mineral salts.
The only thing that we've done so far,
trace mineral salts, I'd say.
Is probably add some silver to the water. But we are going to be, it is on the list to get the minerals.
Okay. I'll show the one I use, but it's quite good. Okay, so we're going to go into the topic today of eating. What we put in our bodies. I'm not going to go too much in terms of the antioxidant nutrients and how certain things reduce disease in our bodies. That's for a later one. But today we're going to talk about eating. And the first scripture I want to go to is in 1 Corinthians 6:19-20. I'm sure it's that one. And let me get where I am first. Yeah. And do you want to read it, or should I read it? I don't mind. 1 Corinthians 6:19-20. If you get it for me, let me know. Okay, I've got it. I'll say it. So, my word says, I'm reading from the King James Version, it says, know you not that your body is a temple of the Ruach HaKodesh, it says Holy Spirit or Holy Ghost, which is in you, which you have of Yah and not of your own. So, our bodies, given to us by the Most High, is, and the temple that resides in us, is a baruching from us. We're working this, the Holy Spirit's in us, so the Ruach HaKodesh. And what I'm just trying to kind of get at is that if that temple's in us, we need to keep it pure. We cannot eat the things of the world and what we put in it, things that are not pure, that are not natural, and operate in line with the Most High. That's what I'm just going to put there straight, that's what I'm going to say. Okay? Now, there's certain things that we can't help, or we can help, but we can't help. So there's certain things like organic foods, the soil, okay? So the soil that we currently use now is nowhere near has the same nutrient value as it did many, many years ago. It says our ancestors, you know, there's a graph that shows the levels, and I mentioned it last time, the difference in terms of what the soil they used, what we use now, it won't be. So we're already at a kind of downfall already. But what we can do is we can try and eat what the Most High has told us to eat. So eating from what the Word says, okay? So as my brother Duke says, you know, I love the word he says, even he says Frankenstein food. And I love that because it's basically modified food. So when we put modified foods in us, we want to function in the right way, and we can't, it's impossible. Okay, so when we eat food, okay, yeah, or certain foods we eat, there's something called, you know, our stomach, which we all know goes through, you know, through our mouths, down the esophagus, into small intestines and our stomach and all sorts. But the stomach is known as the second brain. Has anybody heard that before?
Yeah.
Okay. So every disease, and you know, you may, don't listen to me, also go and test everything and make sure what I'm saying is true, or you may have other spins on it, but everything we eat goes from, every disease starts from the stomach, mm-hmm. basically, yeah? Yes. So when you eat foods, you go to the stomach. Disease starts from there, okay, yeah? So we need to make sure that what we're eating and putting into our bodies is either two things. So it's one thing, basically. Whatever we're eating should be fighting against disease, not making sure we get disease, okay, yeah? So there's a saying, isn't there? You know, you may have heard it. It says, every bite you take, you either feeding disease or you are fighting or healing disease, okay, yeah? So so I'm just gonna kind of touch on that, yeah? Quick test for you, because I said something like 2 weeks ago, those that weren't there probably won't remember. Who can remember what the three eyes are? Three eyes. I.
Three bees.
Oh, no. Excellent. I was gonna say hallelujah, high five. Can anybody remember what it was? Three eyes. My theme for today is hallelujah, high five. Yeah, it is all, yeah. Hallelujah, well done. Fantastic, okay, yeah. So there's something called that happens. So when we eat foods, it causes, you know, certain foods, of course, irritation, inflammation, or infection, okay? So if you're eating good foods, foods that are phytonutrients, like plant-based foods, then you won't get those three things, because those things are going to produce good things in your body. Those three things are negative things, okay? So, inflammatory foods. Does anyone want to throw anything at me? Inflammatory
milk.
Foods.
Huh? Milk.
Milk. I'll say why milk, but that's going to cause a long conversation. I'm talking about them, the growth hormones and that. I won't go there right now. Mm-hmm. Anything else? Pardon?
Salty food.
Salt, okay. Salt, one, yeah.
Scavengers.
Huh?
Scavengers.
Yes. Yeah. It is, of course it is, definitely, yeah. We're going to go into it later. I won't go into it right now. Or in the beach, should I say. Okay, so I'm just going to kind of just touch baseline. I'm not going to go too deep into the foods. So I'll put alcohol. Obviously the reason why it's processed and what it does to our bodies if we drink too much of it, which we don't do here. Processed foods.
Hallelujah.
Who knows what processed foods I'm on about?
McDonald's.
Okay. McDonald's, causing more illness and diseases.
Chicken nuggets.
Okay, so basically processed foods, okay, yeah? So anything that comes in a can, in a bag, in a packet, anything that doesn't come naturally, okay, is a processed food. Anything that has more than, I'd say, one ingredient, or three ingredients, should I say, a packet of crisps, for example, if you eat really salty crisps, they probably come with salt, oil, and potatoes. So even that is, you know, classed as a processed food, isn't it? Okay, so processed foods and what was the other one? Oils and salt, okay, yeah? So one of what I didn't anybody mention, which I expected to hear,
sugar,
which is causing inflammation within 5 minutes.
Sugars.
Huh?
Sugar.
Excellent, well done, sugar. As soon as you have, not natural sugars like fructose, that's in fruits, but as soon as you have a sugar, as in refined sugar, table sugar, yeah, it spikes your blood sugar in 5 minutes, okay? So when you have natural sugars, it doesn't do that, okay?
Sorry
to cut
you.
No.
This just is because you mentioned fructose,
yeah,
and obviously I know you know the difference between the fructose syrup, so just touching on that, could you let them know about the difference between the fructose that you're talking about and the fructose syrup?
Okay.
Glucose syrup.
Okay. So there's different, he's talking about sweeteners, yeah, because, you know, so there's different sugars and sweeteners, okay, yeah? So there is 56 titles for the name of sugar in packaged foods that we eat, okay, yeah? And that's quite a lot. People say sugar, you know, sweeteners, but there's things like corn syrup, high fructose syrup, aspartame, acetaflame, stevia is actually a good one you can have. Stevia or xylitol is the best two you can have because they are plant-based, they're still synthetic. So when you look at packet foods and they have things like high fructose corn syrup or sugar, but there's different, so many different names that I haven't, in my head I can't remember all 56, can I? That's impossible. Well, you never know. But the difference between fructose and high fructose corn syrup is the processing in terms of natural and unnatural, okay? So fructose that you see in a, for instance, a plum or a pear or banana, those are actually fructose from a fruit which are natural, and those things, they will not spike your blood sugar levels at all. Now there is debates about low glycemic index foods in terms of fruits. Some are high like bananas, and then you got berries. So you got different levels of glucose and fructose, should I say, that the fruit produces. But to me that's a bit of a myth. Some people say when they're trying to lose weight they shouldn't stay off certain high sugar fruits or high fructose fruits like bananas and things like that. But me personally, to me, all fruits are healthy, but I won't go into it right now. I'll do another talk on that. But if you are trying to lose weight, then I would. I'm not trying to contradict myself here, but if you are trying to lose weight, then there's, I would limit to a point of having too many fruits. But anyway, yeah. Anything else on that?
It was just the use of glucose fructose syrup.
Yeah.
And basically the harmfulness of it.
Okay, so when we have fructose syrup or sweetener, okay, yeah, that's what causes inflammation to our body. So once we have that and we put it in us, it causes inflammation from the stomach and then it dissects into. So certain sweeteners affect your central nervous system, so your CNS, and then that affects your brain, which your cells call the glial cells. You might have heard of it. Don't go too technical, but basically, when you have that, there's two things it does. It causes inflammation, it spikes your blood sugar levels, and then it also, it's in a very high addictive food. So what happens is you have it and then you want to crave more, okay? Then I could go on to something like ghrelin, which is a hunger hormone. Have you ever heard of ghrelin before? Ghrelin? It's a hunger hormone. I'll give you an example, okay. If you're sitting at home watching a movie and you have a big, huge packet of family packet of crisps, okay? Don't ask me to put your hands up, but I've done it myself, I know I have. I've sat there and eaten a whole bag of crisps, okay? And not knowing, okay, yeah? And then you look at the packet and you turn it over and say, well, 750 calories. No way. And then you think like, and then you start to feel guilty about it. But I do anyway, if I've done that. Okay? So if I asked you to eat, for instance, 2 jack potatoes, could anybody do that? Well, some probably could. But you'd be full, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
Even if you had 1, you'd be full, but you could eat a whole bag of crisps and still probably think, okay, I've got room for more, like I've got room for some sweets or something like that. So basically what happens is, it's a hormone hunger called ghrelin, G-H-R, and basically it kind of tricks you to think that you're not satisfied because you're not basically, okay, yeah. So that's a hunger hormone that kind of affects you. So there's other kind of areas that I will talk about that I don't want to go too much into it because it goes deeper, okay, so, yeah. So, talking about the SAD diet, anyone heard that the acronym before? It's not an acronym, I'll just call it SAD diet. So the SAD diet is a diet that we constantly eat the... Pardon? Say it, man, say it. So the SAD diet is what we need to move away from, okay? So the diet where we feed our children a lot of junk food. Every weekend we have snacks and we have sweets and we have crisps and we have McDonald's and we have, you know, frozen foods and we have... Frozen foods depends, ain't too bad, depends what they are. Frozen veg is good. And then we have all these kind of SAD diet foods that cause us problems in our body, okay? And what we need to do is come away from that and have a well-balanced diet. So if you look at a plate, how we're supposed to eat really is half up. Basically, a lot of people, when you eat food, like I give an example, when you have a plate of food, most people go for the meats, the chicken, and those things first, they go on your plate. What we're supposed to do to eat healthy is we're supposed to get our plate and we're supposed to have half of our plate first with veg and salads, okay? And then the other bit, you have a grain, and then the other quarter, then you have your chicken or your fish or your meat. That's what it's supposed to be, but we tend to put everything on first, the meat, the chicken, and then we kind of put a little bit of salad at the end, you know, just to make it look good, to make it look colourful. But that's not the right way. But I'm going to go into meat anyway. So we need to come away from that diet, because that diet where we eat, when we eat a lot of that junk food, is I class that as I put it as OSD, and it's not an acronym for nothing. I just say that kind of food, how we're eating, is making us 3 things. It's making us obese, sick, and depressed. And the reason why I say depressed, because I will probably go about it in the next talk, is certain foods that we eat affect our DNA. No, it does. No, it's not certain foods. All foods that we eat affect our DNA. Okay, I could go on to the epigenome, how to change our epigenome and things like that, but it affects our DNA. So there's certain foods that we eat that cause anxiety and depression and other mood things that affect us. So when you see a lot of children now, or young people, and they have things like, right, we've talked about this, they have like mental health, and they have Asperger's and ADHD. I'm not saying those things are the reason why they have that, because other reasons why children obtain those things, you know, i.e. immunizations and things like that. But those things contribute to making it worse, okay? So,
I don't know if you're aware, but you're aware of the study that was carried out on that small town where the children were suffering with, families where the children were suffering with ADHD, and they changed the diet of all of those children that they monitored. Yeah. And they, when they gave them like natural foods and cut out all the processed stuff, that their behavior changed, and the symptoms that they were displaying before went. Yeah.
That's my opinion. It's similar to things like that, because I've read a lot about those things, and I know, and I'm 100% advocate for this, that if you change, if you can find a root cause of your illness, your mood disorder, your issues going on, if you weren't born with it, you can reverse it. That's what I'm trying to say, basically.
Yes.
Yeah? Because a lot of things that the food that we eat and what they're putting in is the reason why we're becoming sick. And becoming, you know, having diseases, okay, basically. So if we can find the root cause, you can heal from it, okay? So when Brother Dwayne mentioned there's lots of studies about people that have reversed illness and diseases, you know, degenerative diseases, based on just changing their lifestyles, you know, of eating, of being more active, of changing their mindset, how they even think as well. So that, you know, just touching on that is amazing. And I will just quickly mention, so three things that we need to do if we want to reverse any kind of illness or anything that's in our bodies that shouldn't be in there or make us feel a certain way is we need to remove waste. Okay, I talked about that earlier, about 2 weeks ago, about water, about fasting, detoxing. Okay, so because bugs love waste, so when we have things like parasites and things that are in our bodies from certain foods that we've eaten and certain things, we need to reverse that. So what we need to do is we need to build up our hydrochloric acid in our stomachs, and I will talk about that another time. There's a lot of things I'm talking about another time, isn't there? Yeah, because I think there's so much I can go into, and I'm trying to make sure that it's, I don't go off track. But basically, our hydrochloric acid in our stomachs and not what it should be. And you know, your stomach acid in your stomach should be able to, if you ate a finger, don't eat no fingers, guys. If you ate a finger, your stomach acid should be able to dissolve even down to the bone. Supposed to, that's how strong it's supposed to be. So, don't do that, by the way. Don't do that at home.
So how do you then build up your stomach acid?
So that's what I want to kind of get into. Well, I'm not going to talk about it now, if that's all right. It's basically changing our diet, basically. And I'll show you how to do that another time, okay? Yeah. So we need to cleanse the colon. The other tips are clean our colon, cleansing the colon, because everything comes through the colon to your stomach. And we need to cleanse the liver and the lymphatic system, okay? Yeah. So the next topic I'm going to talk about, the auric value, which is the oxygen radical absorbance capacity. And what that does, that kind of, the foods that we eat, the good foods, like the healthy foods right here, it has a value of the antioxidant value. And basically, the better foods we eat, things like blueberries and figs and dates and, you know, or your cruciferous veg like broccoli, Brussels sprouts, those kind of things, they are high antioxidant levels. The highest ones you have, the better for your body to heal and to cleanse. Okay, yeah. So I kind of touched on it, but and also not just the liver, the lymphatic system as well, because the lymphatic system is what pushes out waste out of your body, as well as other areas. You get what I mean? Okay. How long have we got?
5 minutes.
Okay. I'm just going to talk about the unforgiving four, that's what I call it, and these are four things that are in foods and in the air that we breathe, and things that we kind of need to try and find a way to get it out of our system, basically, come out of our system. And the first one is DDT. You may not have heard of it. Has anybody heard of DDT?
Yeah,
rested. I love it. Nah, so basically it's an insecticide. An insecticide, that's the name, but you've all heard of all the other what's called pesticides, herbicides, fungicides. So these things are really the foods that we eat, and we need to kind of, that's something that once it goes up by, it's hard to kind of remove, but there's things that you can put in there to get out, okay, yeah? So there's DDT, radiation, toxic heavy metals, and it's called viral. What it's called HHV, which basically means herpes viral, which things that we put in, that viral things that affect our body internally. Okay, so there's heavy metals that are in there that we need to kind of remove as well, that are linked to Alzheimer's and dementia. So the two that I mentioned, heavy metals, are three: mercury, aluminium, fluoride. Any more you can think of? Nickel, lead, copper. Copper is a bit of a debatable one, really, because they're saying that copper is actually, it's meant to be really good for you. But when I looked at copper, I looked at it as a heavy metal that we shouldn't be drinking from. But now the studies say that coffee is meant to be good for you.
Yeah,
so,
it's good.
So I'm not too sure about that. Okay, yeah. So removing heavy metals, I'm going to give you a list of a few things that you can do to remove these heavy metals from your body. Okay, coriander is a really, really an amazing detoxifier from the body. Yeah. So, you know, I'd say always use that in your food. You can freeze it as well, and you can put it into your foods. Celery juice. If you look at the benefits of celery juicing, you know, it's just amazing. You know, any kind of skin ailments, any kind of conditions in your gut, celery juice is an amazing. That's what probably top of my list.
Yeah. Where do you buy that?
Celery juice.
Buy the celery and juice it.
Yeah, simple. You can buy a juicer, a bus juicer, I've got one. There's different ones juicers. You can get a centrifugal juicer which spins, and they say don't use that because of the heat and it kind of oxidizes your veg. Me personally, I'd say your best juicer is the one you're going to use. So, you know, the one I've got two actually, which one's a very expensive one, a cold pressed one. That's called a Norwalk. But the juice that you want to get is just get a basic one from B&M, £50, and you can juice as much as you want. Quite easy to clean as well, and you'll get all your, you know, your vitamins and minerals, because once you juice, it's kind of concentrated. So, you know, imagine buying a celery, which you can buy from a shop for 70p.
Yeah.
You know, you may be, I won't say the word, but obviously celery, organic. You want to try and get organic if you can, but if you can't, I'd still say juice it because it's amazing. It's not one of the, with fruits and veg, you've got something called a bottle of chop now, something called Cleaning 15 and the Dirty Dozen. Have you heard that before?
Yeah.
Okay, so you've got certain, the Cleaning 15 are foods that you can eat that have a low level of pesticides. Cleaning 15, Google it, you'll see, or you've got the Dirty Dozen. That's the ones that you need to try and buy organically. And the highest list of ones, things like apples, like, you know, if you can. So,
have you got anything that you can send out on the roof from there?
Yeah, I can. I can send that. Yeah, definitely. I'll do that. I'll do it while I'm sitting down. Yeah. So, I'm off track now. I forgot where I was.
Juicing.
Yeah, celery juicing. Yeah, basically. Yeah. So, look it up. Look it up. Just, you know, I'd say that's something you can incorporate into your life straight away. So, coriander, celery juicing, and also selenium. Does anyone know what selenium is in? Brazil nuts, okay, I won't go on there. So Brazil nuts and zinc is to remove mercury. So selenium removes aluminium from the body and zinc removes mercury, okay, yeah. Does anybody know high zinc foods?
Brussels sprouts.
Yeah, Brussels sprouts. Yeah. Yeah. Spinach has got zinc in, but not too much, but yeah. Okay, I'm gonna leave you this quick study, okay. Amazing study, I've got to share with you. Confident on there because I'm not ready. I'm not set up like that yet. But I will be.
It's coming, man. It's coming.
Alzheimer's and dementia. Okay, there's certain things we have right here that we eat. Something called MSG, monosodium glutamate. Okay, that is a dangerous, dangerous food that we need to remove from our system as much as possible. Okay, it's known as the Chinese salt, and they've got hidden names, the other names, just like the sugars, 56 sugars that are in. Hidden in the, like, you know, ingredients list, there's something called natural flavorings or flavor. If you see anything linked with natural flavor or flavor, natural vanilla flavoring, natural chocolate flavoring or chocolate flavoring, anything you see that in a food, that's basically known as MSG. So I guarantee if you look at your top 10 list of foods in your cupboards, it will have natural flavor in it. Herbal teas, chewing gums, sweets, everything, and it's hidden in it, and we don't know. And basically, we're consuming this. We say it says natural flavoring, but it's actually known as MSG. So don't quote me. Do your research, and you'll see yourselves. That affects our central nervous system and damages our brains, and that's why a lot of people, especially old people, have dementia and Alzheimer's. Okay. So there was a study by a lady. I'm going to finish here. She's a doctor named Dr. Mary Newport. And she did a study, you could Google her on YouTube, her name's Mary Newport, and she worked as a doctor in a neonatal surgery for children that are obviously born premature. Quite one more too much into the story. Her husband was diagnosed with Alzheimer's, and he was the accountant for the family business. And basically, she came across this, you can look at yourself, it's in an 8-minute video, it's not long. She came across this active ingredient called MGT, I think it's called that. MCT, sorry. Medium chain triglycerides. And she used this natural ingredient to cure her husband. She did her own kind of clinical trial on her husband to cure him in, I think, about 6 months, I think. Right, yeah. Just by just using these active ingredients. And active ingredients, does anybody know what it's in? Wondering. Give me another hallelujah high five. Superb. Okay, yeah.
Natural.
Next, natural, yeah, so organic coconut oil. This active ingredient, she found out it was in this, because that's what they fed to neonatal babies that are premature, and it helped them with their brain capacity and obviously growth in their growth as well. So she basically did a study with her husband. She went through a trial, and he had to draw a clock, and he drew a circle and got number 12 and number 3, I think, and that was the end. He missed the trial based on that because he didn't get enough score points. So I think it was a couple of days later, she found this out, and she goes, oh, we've got another trial coming up. So she fed him this, I think, 2 spoonfuls of coconut oil in his, they said oatmeal, obviously it's Americans, we say porridge, yeah? And basically, he got through the clinical trial just based on having coconut oil. And so basically, after that, she worked out the value of how much she needed, and it basically, I think, 2 spoonfuls of coconut oil, and she fed him this in his porridge every day, I think up to 6 months. And she realised that within so many months, that she went to a appointment with herself at a doctor's, and what happened was, he was sitting in the waiting room, and after they left the appointment, they were driving home, and he spoke and told her everything in the whole magazine. He recounted everything in the whole magazine, what he read in the story. And the reason why I say it's amazing, because before he had the coconut oil and everything, he couldn't do anything. He couldn't dig a hole because he was planting. He wasn't sure where to put the plant in or take it out. He was that far gone with Alzheimer's. And basically, that one ingredient transformed his life and reversed that illness. So I'm just going to leave it there. So one thing to incorporate into your lifestyle is MCT oil.
Just before you wrap up, just quickly, you mentioned cold press.
Yeah.
And I only found out the difference between cold press and that concentrate stuff quite recently. Could you quickly just touch on that a little bit?
Okay, so with coconut oils and other things as well, like oils that we use, like, you know, olive oil, some things are cold press, some things are not, okay? The pressing of it basically is just that you keep all the nutrient value in the foods and the oils that you use. So once it's cold pressed and it's organic, and it's basically it's going to keep all its value. So if you brought coconut oil not cold pressed, for instance, then you know it's been oxidized because it's been used with heat. Now what I will say about coconut oil is it's the one oil that you can use frying and cooking up to 400 Fahrenheit, and it won't oxidize your food, which means your food will not become carcinogenic. Okay, yeah? So coconut oil is the one you can use that will not become that. Any other oils, like olive oil, flax oil, you're supposed to use it just cold on cold food and salads. Okay, so it's kind of essential to use it. I buy my coconut oil from Lidl, £2.49. Okay, Aldi used to do it. I think they might still do it. And so did B&M, but I think they've stopped now, they've got the pouches. But if you're going to cook anything, if you're frying anything, use coconut oil. That's my, you know, I'll say it, yeah. Sorry first, Ishmael first, your question.
I just wanted to just clarify on the natural flavour and what they said. It's in your minty and...
Well, if you look in your ingredients, it's in a lot of teas. It'll say natural. For instance, if you bought like peppermint tea, it'll say natural peppermint. That is not actually, it's not actually natural peppermint, it's actually MSG, but probably peppermint in it. But basically what you need to hear is peppermint extract or vanilla extract. If it's extract, that's not a problem. But when you see the word natural or flavouring next to orange or lime, you know it's actually MSG, but hidden name. Okay.
MSG.
Yeah, MSG. Minus all the glutamate. Yeah.
Sorry, can I just ask
one?
What about rapeseed oil?
Well, rapeseed oil has a number of different names. Okay, that's the British name that they use for canola oil. Personally, I wouldn't use it. The oils that I would use if you're going to cook is coconut oil, and you can get odorless I mean, it's got no flavour to coconut. If you don't like the flavour of coconut, flavours in terms of coconut. But if you're going to cook with anything, coconut oil, you can use flaxseed oil, which is beneficial as well, or olive oil. Okay. I would kind of stay away from sunflower oil. Sunflower oil is meant to be okay as well, but the problem is it's when you heat it and cook with it and fry it, because that oil, they're not very good at keeping the nutrients in it, and they become oxidized, so they then become carcinogenic, which are linked to when anything's oil that's fried or fried and becomes like raw food and making, you know, like an egg, and it becomes really, really like darky, like crispy. It becomes carcinogenic, which is kind of the same as smoking cigarettes. That's the value. So basically, that's it really. Anything else before I finish?
So best oil.
Huh?
Best oil is coconut oil.
Coconut oil. You could use ghee, butter, but that's from animals, so I wouldn't say that. But I'm not anti-animal products. But yeah, I say coconut oil, flaxseed oil, or olive oil.
What about hemp oil?
Well, hemp oil is a different ball game altogether. I'm glad you touched on that. I'm not ready to talk about hemp oil. I could do, but hemp oil is amazing. It's an amazing because it comes from the plant, the cannabis plants. Does anybody know where the oil comes from? Hemp oil. What part of the plant? Does anybody know?
Roots,
yeah, the seed. Mm. So the hemp oil from hemp oil, yeah, comes from the seed. Okay, so it comes from the seed. So if you want to use hemp oil, definitely, but it's a bit expensive, I'd say. Yeah, so definitely, it's one that I would advocate for. Yeah, 100%
hemp oil. You can cook with that.
Yeah, you can. I will do. There's a lot of will doers that I'm gonna do, but in terms of the benefits of that plant and the medicinal purposes, I will do a teaching on that as well, 100%, because I think you have to get it out there, because it's got a lot of, you know, healing for our bodies. Okay?
Where did you get hemp oil from?
You can make it yourself.
Holland and Barrett.
You can go to Holland and Barrett. You can go to Holland and Barrett and get it. But, yeah.
At the back, we keep the catalogues for all the natural stuff. So we've got the whole catalogues next door. That you can take away, you can order the stuff online, and it is affordable as well.
Yeah, you can get it online as well, yeah, you can. It's just trusting the sources where it comes from, really. But yeah, it's something that we definitely use. Okay, I'll wrap it up.